You are all welcome to the today's program meant for MBA second year students studying financial management. Today's topic for discussion is capital structure theories. Without capital, no firm can exist. You are aware that capital is like lifeblood for the survival of any organization. We have the subject experts with us to discuss the topic. Left to me is Dr. K. Swami, Associate Professor of Business Management, Dr. B. R. Ambedkar Open University. And extreme left to me is Dr. B. Brahmaya, Professor of Finance. Sir, Dr. Swami, what is capital?
In layman's language, capital is nothing but long-term investment. Before going to capital, let me explain you the basic objectives of financial management. Financial management is basically concerned with the providing money on time. It's not only providing on time, the financial management is concerned with the economical way of financing the business activities. The financial management all the times aims at minimizing the cost and maximizing the profit. In the process, it will focus all the time how best it can minimize the cost and maximize the profit. It's not only providing funds on time, it is also concerned with the effective utilization of the finances. So for any financial manager, they have to make use the finances very effectively, that is optimally. It's nothing but there must be a tangible profit. I mean, as far as possible, the cost has to be reduced and profit has to be maximized. That is the idea of any financial management. In view of this, whatever capital a firm requires is going to be raised through different sources. I mean, it could be either long term or short term, but normally whatever finances you raise through long term is known as investment or capital in any business organization. That is capital. Once you know the capital, immediately the immediate question is, the capital can be raised in the form of equity or ownership or in the form of loan or debt. So whatever finances the business firm requires could be raised either in the form of ownership or in the form of debt or loan capital. These two are long-term investments. Here we are not talking anything about short-term investments. It's only long-term investment. When we refer to the equity capital, that is ownership capital, there are basically three important things that do come under equity or ownership capital. Number one is equity share capital. Number two is preference share capital. Number three is retained earnings. Retained earnings are nothing but the profits or the surplus of profit that is left after meeting all the expenses, which will be used only for the business purpose. The third category, that is preference share capital. Now, there is a lot of difference between equity share capital and preference share capital. Equity shareholders, they are the real owners of the business. Whether the firm incurs loss or profit, they are the people who is going to enjoy. When we talk about preference share capital, by name, it's very clear. Preference shareholders have two preferences. Number one is to get a fixed rate of dividend at the end of every year. Number two is when the company goes into liquidation, they will have the primary right to take back their capital when compared to the equity shareholders. These two are the important components under the equity share capital. Retained earnings, as it is surplus of profit that is available automatically when the dividend that is payable to the preference shareholders is paid, whatever is left that belongs to the equity shareholders only. In that sense, equity shareholders are the real owners. When we talk about the debt component, Debt component is nothing but raising the required funds through debt capital. The debt capital could be either in the form of long term loan or in the form of bonds, debentures, whatever it may be. Now, the basic difference between the ownership capital and debt capital is the owners at the end of the year are entitled to get dividend over the investment, that is ownership. When we talk about debt capital, the suppliers of the debt capital, they are entitled to get only interest. The very idea here is the interest that is payable to the debt owners or money supplier is treated just like any other expenditure and that is allowed before tax. That is the only charm why we go for debt capital. So, as a finance manager, the idea, the objective is to minimize the cost and maximize the profit. In that process, to the extent possible, we make all the required calculations and see that how best and what mix of capital, that is debt and equity component, will give the maximum return and minimum cost.
Dr. Brahmaya, what do you mean by capital structure? How it is different from financial structure?
As we discussed, as Professor Swami has already mentioned about the capital, debt and equity, preference capital. Capital structure is nothing but the composition of the capital. Basically, two major components, debt capital and equity capital. The equity capital is being contributed by the promoter or the owners or the proprietor. In case of the partner, the individual proprietor concerned, proprietor brings into equity. In the case of the partnership firm, the partners bring in the form of a partner's capital, whereas in the case of the joint stock companies, that is the companies which are incorporated under the Companies Act, the shareholders, the promoter group as well as other shareholders bring by way of the capital which is known as a share capital. And the equity, the debt, the borrowings either from the financial institutions or from the banks or from the market, which is being brought by way of fixed term with the specified interest rate is called debt. Debt means it is IOU, that means the company borrows for the business operations, that is called debt. The composition of debt and equity is called capital. Capital employed means the capital structure. If you look at the finance function, one of the important functions of financial management is a financing decision, that is a financing, that is a liability side. If you talk about total liabilities, that is a debt, equity plus reserves and surplus, that together called as a capital. If you come down the line, the current, the short term debt, medium term debt and other current liabilities are all called financial structure. The total size or this side of the liability side is called financial structure. The upper portion, that is share capital, reserves and surplus, which together are called as a net worth, and the debt is called capital. And below that, the medium term debt, short term debt and the working current liabilities are called financial structure. For simplicity, the debt capital is a narrow term, the finance is a financial structure is a broader term. There is a relationship between capital structure and financial structure, both are sources. Financial structure, short term as well as current liabilities are also added. If one deletes or one eliminates the current liabilities as well as the short term borrowings, that is a capital structure.
What are the factors we have to keep in mind while designing capital structure?
So, capital structure is nothing but composition of debt and equity components. It is a mix of debt and equity. While designing the capital structure of any business organization, we have to keep in mind certain important factors. Number one is cost. As it is, we were talking about the financial management objectives. The objective of any financial management is to minimize the cost, reduction of cost. Reduction of cost is nothing but increasing the profit. So, the first one is what kind of mix, what kind of composition of debt and equity is going to yield minimum cost. So, to the extent possible, we have to opt for such a composition where the cost of capital is minimum. When we talk about bonds, on bonds we have to pay interest. Interest is nothing but in financial management, technically we call it cost. So the cost has to be minimal. That is the first criteria which we have to keep in mind. The second one is control. Control is nothing but here, I very briefly explained the difference between the equity shareholders and preference shareholders. Preference shareholders, only for namesake, they are the owners of the business organization. But in actual terms, equity shareholders are alone the owners of the business. So here what happens is, preference shareholders, they will not have any right to vote. So they will not take part in the decision making process. It is only equity shareholders who is going to take decisions. So it's very clear, who is controlling the business affairs of a business organization? It is only equity shareholders, it is not preference shareholders. Naturally, by nature, all the time we prefer to control the affairs. So we don't wish to get diluted the control among many shareholders. So while designing the capital structure, what we do is, controlling is also very important. To the extent possible, what we do is, we would like to retain the control within few members. We don't allow to get it diluted. So that is, controlling is another one. So cost, control. The third one is risk. Risk is in different ways. Suppose we are trying to go for such a mix where the cost of capital is minimum and the returns are high. In such a case, in the process of combining the debt and mix, it's very clear, just now I have mentioned, the interest payable to the bondholders or loan is tax exempted. The dividend payable to the either preference shareholders or equity shareholders is not tax free. It is after tax. First you have to pay the tax, then only you may have to declare the dividend either to the equity shareholders or to the preference shareholders. So here what happens is, wherever there is a tax element, automatically wherever there is a tax implication, tax is going to be treated as an expenditure just like any other thing and is deducted from the EBIT. So automatically what happens is, the cost of debt will be economical, or the cost of debt will be cheaper than cost of equity. Here the logic is only tax. Other than tax, there is no charm at all. So cost of debt is cheaper than cost of equity. So at the same time, as you go on increase the composition of debt, the profitability may increase. Because of the tax component, the risk may increase. Whether you earn profit or not, you have to pay the interest. So risk is increasing. If you combine equity or preference share capital, automatically what happens is, in case the firm is not earning any profit, you need not pay any dividend to the equity shareholders. So it's very clear, there is no risk. Equity share capital is nothing but risk-free capital, whereas debt capital is, it is risk. So we have to go for such a balance where the risk and return is balanced. That is the third idea behind it. The fourth one is timing. Timing is the primary responsibility of any finance manager is to provide the funds on time, that is at times of need. Whenever there is a need, he must be in a position to provide the funds at economical rate. It's not only providing, you may be providing funds but at higher cost. That is not the professionalism. What you have to do is, you have to provide the funds economically at cheaper rate of interest, cheaper rate of cost. So timing is very important. That is a fourth point. In addition to these four, we can also include flexibility. Flexibility is nothing but, today you have limited amount of capital. You may depend on borrowings. You can raise the capital through debt, through bonds, which are payable in coming forth. Okay. Whenever you feel you can stand on your own legs, whenever you feel that you are comfortable, whenever you start earning, in such a case, what you can do is you can redeem the debt capital and you can totally depend on your own capital. So that is also there, that is a kind of flexibility. If you go for the issue of equity share capital, automatically equity shares cannot be redeemed. If you go for debt capital can be released at any moment. So that is the flexibility.
What are the different kinds of risks? What is the relationship between risks and capital structure?
As Mr. Swami has dealt in detail about the costs involved with the debt and the costs involved with the equity, as he has pointed out, the debt capital has a fixed obligation on the firm. Therefore, when the firm borrows by way of debt, it has an obligation to repay the principal in that specified terms, that is installments, repayment of the installments along with interest and agreed coupon rate. In case of the equity, if the firm generates a good income or generates good ROI, and if it is a surplus income, that is a profit after tax, part of profit after tax is being distributed to the shareholders. Therefore, the costs involved with the debt and equity are different in nature. In the cost on the debt is a fixed, therefore it is a obligation on the firm to repay. Therefore, the capacity of the company to generate adequate returns to repay, that is a debt servicing capacity. Therefore, in the case of the debt, the company will have an obligation, therefore it is a risk for the company, that is a interest payment risk. And in the case of the equity, when the business generates income, then the equity shareholders are getting the benefit by way of dividends. Therefore, if you talk about the risk in terms of the company, for the company by borrowing debt, there is a bankruptcy risk. If the company cannot generate adequate returns, therefore there is a default in the principal repayment as well as default in the interest rate. The default in the interest rate and default in the installment lead for a negative name or fall of the reputation in the company, that company has to pay higher rate of interest for further borrowing. Because when the default in the principal, that rating comes down and this company will not be rated as investment rated company by the rating agencies. Similarly, investors will feel by investing that company, they have to charge risk premium. Therefore, the cost and the further debt will be very higher. When the company is not doing well and it is defaulting on the debt payment, the shareholders in the widely held company will try to liquidate in the market and there is a pressure on the market price, therefore the prices will come down. Therefore, by attempting to borrow, high leveraging has impact on the equity also. Therefore, one has to make out the balancing. The borrowing, therefore, company in financial management will suffer the financial leverage or the financial risk. Financial risk is the risk which by having borrowed money. In the equity, there is no risk because the reputation as well as the market price may collapse, but the shareholder, the company is safe or the promoters are safe not to refund because there is no question of redemption as Professor Swami mentioned in the case of the equity. In the debt, it is a repayable or it is a redeemed. In case of the debentures, these are to be redeemed. In case of the bonds, these are to be serviced. And these problems were there. Therefore, in the capital structure, one has to see the risk return parity. The investor will see risk return parity. The company has to see a risk and is a return. If it is a generating the return, then there is no problem. If the interest cost is greater than your ROI, that is a return on investment, the company is going to face the bankruptcy risk and income risk. Because of this risk, it all indirectly leads for a fall in the credit rating. Fall in the credit rating leads to the perception of the investors that the company is high risk and therefore the investors either in the equity or in the debt expect a higher return. Therefore, this way the company cost of capital goes up. when the company cost of capital goes up, the financial leverage has a burden on financial implications. Your return will come down, your EPS will come down, ultimately the value of the firm will come. The wealth maximization will not be there, therefore there is an erosion in the equity and there is a probability of technical insolvency or the bankruptcy. Therefore, in the case of the capital structure, the risk of finance, that is a financial leverage, that is a fixed cost obligation, has an impact on the company performance as well as company earning potential. Therefore, higher the debt, higher the risk, lower the debt, lower the risk. And why the, in spite of the higher risk, why companies tend to borrow high? Because they wanted to trade on equity, that is a leveraging effect, because they, as Professor Swami has mentioned initially, that the interest cost is to be debited to PL and account before profit after tax. Therefore, whatever item is being debited to the PL and account, to that extent the income tax is reduced. Therefore, we call on tax and shield. To have the benefit of the tax and shield, the higher income tax bracket companies can borrow heavily and they get the tax shield. If the company is not generating adequate profits and if it is not in the tax bracket, if income tax is not being paid with that company, if it is incurring losses, there is no question of a tax shield on interest. Therefore, depending on the tax bracket of the company, companies try to borrow, tend to borrow in the debt market to have a tax shield. If there is no tax shield on effect on the interest, then the debt cost and the equity cost will not have a much impact on that. Both the incomes are taxable at the disposal at the receiver end. Therefore, debenture holder has to pay in, because in India we have a 12,000 exemption on the debt in interest and income as well as dividends are together. Therefore, it is not a much difference for the shareholder or the debenture holder, but the company, it is being deducted. Therefore, by tempting or by indulging the debt borrowing, company has a leverage risk or financial risk, which has impact on EPS, and in EPS in turn will have impact on the credit rating of the company.
What is optimal capital structure?
Now, optimal capital structure, it's nothing but designing the composition of the capital or mixing of debt and equity component in such a way where the cost will become very nominal and the profit will increase. So, we have to work out various proportions or various mix of debt and equity components. So, we have to find out at what mix the cost is very nominal and the profit is very high. That is called optimal capital structure.
What are the various theories on capital structure, and also explain NI and ROE approaches?
As we discussed about capital structure theories or the capital structure deductions, you see, as we talk about different mix of the debt and equity has a different connotation. That is a capital structure deduction. Apart from that, in the literature, in the financial literature, we have a different theories. What we call a traditional theory or net income approach, NOI, net operating income approach, MM theory, that is a Modigliani-Miller approach, which is one of the theories which is based on that. Then after that, you have a risk-reward trade-off theory. In the basic theory, in the net approach, the net operating income approach, capital structure and the value of the firm is indifferent. That means, in an optimum capital structure, the mix of the debt and equity has a bearing on a capital structure and the cost of capital. In the net operating income approach, the weighted average cost of capital, the weighted average cost of capital means the cost of debt plus cost of equity in terms of weights of the respective components is called weighted average cost of capital. In the case of the net operating income approach, the weighted average cost of capital is, weighted average cost of capital is independent of the capital structure. If you use more debt, initially the debt cost will come down. After certain stage, the cost of debt starts increasing. When the cost of debt increases, automatically the weighted cost of capital goes up. When the weighted average cost of capital goes up, automatically the value of firm comes down. Therefore, a net operating approach tells us, saying that when you use net operating approach, the firm will not have an impact on that. In the case of net income approach, where the traditional there is a leverage, there is a cost saving initially use debt, because using a marginal debt or a limited extent debt, the weighted average cost of capital comes down. When the weighted average cost of capital comes down, the value of the firm goes up. The value of the cost of comes down means EPS is going up, ROI is increasing. That means there is a composition where the total cost of capital is less, therefore it is called optimum capital structure. And in that theory, ROI is greater than interest, there is a possibility of using debt. When debt your interest rate is higher than ROI, then it is not worthwhile, it is unfavorable. Then third method, Montagu and Miller approach or MM approach, most popularly known as, it has certain assumptions. They say the capital market is not perfect, debt and equity can be available unlimited, both borrowers as well as the company or the shareholder can borrow limitlessly, and no taxes. When there are no taxes, then MM theory works out, but in a practical world, all over the world, almost all countries have a tax implication. Therefore, that theory, the proposal one, proposition one, ignores the taxes. Therefore, where MM says the debt and equity will not have a bearing, or the mix of the debt and equity will not influence the cost of capital, influence the cost of capital. Therefore, the other approach, risk return trade-off, is between RO and cost of capital. Wherever the total cost of capital is limited or less, that is the optimum capital structure. These are the four important theories when in the financial literature talk about capital structure policies and theories.
What is financial distress?
As we discussed, when some companies tend to borrow very high in the debt market due to a variety of reasons, because equity markets are not favorable and the companies are not in a position to tap the equity market because of a variety of restrictions by the regulator. When they tend to borrow very high and at a certain stage the debt costs are very high and company because of a business cycles will not be in a position to generate the income, therefore they will not be able to service the debt. When they don't service the debt, the ratings automatically comes down and they will not be able to generate the money, and there is a probability of a bankruptcy or the transaction cost. That is, somebody may go to court, there is a technical insolvency or the bankruptcy. And when the company in India also, if some creditor doesn't receive the money, he can file an application with the court of law for winding of the company. The winding of the company are when the net worth becomes, when he doesn't serve the debt holders, that is called as a distress. When he has in a distress, when he has to meet a fixed obligation, he has to tempt or indulge for short-term borrowings or costly borrowings or liquidating of his assets, current assets or fixed assets or some other ways. Therefore, he will not be in a position to do a financial planning, and because of to meet the financial emergencies, he has to do a reckless financing or the hasty financiation that lead to a high cost. Therefore, otherwise finance will, the business will be collapsed or the business firm will be in distress. Therefore, the financial distress is due to fixed obligation of the company to pay debentures or the bonds, debt interest.
Thank you. We have discussed various aspects of capital structure theories. Dr. K. Swami and Professor B. Brahmaya have explained elaborately on the subject. We thank you.